About 20 years ago, I had the opportunity with the Air Force to be briefly deployed to Germany. And while I was there, I went to a concentration camp in the town of Dachau. And little did I know as I was walking through that camp that the mother-in-law of my brother was a prisoner there. I'm going to have my brother's wife come, Vicky, at this time, and she's going to introduce her mother.
Let me see, make sure I get this right. Is this on or good? Raise it up a little bit. We may need to.
We'll adjust.
Okay, that's good. All right, I want to introduce myself. I am Vicky Hornock. I'm Dan's sister-in-law. So, anyway, and I'm Alexandra's daughter. And I wanted to just speak for a moment what it was like. I'm 55 years old, what it was like to grow up with a mother that was a Holocaust survivor. It's pretty fascinating. And just talk about what that impact had on me before she shares her story, because I think that's really what we're talking about today is how God uses these things in our lives and how His grace is sufficient. I remember when I was a little girl and my mom and I would be folding clothes together on the bed, and I used to ask her, like all little girls ask their mothers, what was it like growing up for you? And she would say, I'd rather just take this off. Can I do that? Out. And she would say things like most, like all little girls would ask her, and she would say things like, well, my growing up years were different than your growing up years. I grew up in a big house, kind of like Sound of Music, and then she would sort of get vague about the details. I knew that she had grown up in another country, but I didn't really know what that meant. I also knew that I didn't have grandparents on my mother's side. I only had one set of grandparents, but I sort of figured that was normal because that's all I knew. I didn't really know that everybody had usually two sets of grandparents. But it was later in life, when I was a little bit older, maybe 9 or 10 years old, I heard my mother speak at a church gathering, and I kind of heard about the fact that she was had been in a concentration camp, but I didn't really know what that meant. But this is what I did know about my mother. I knew that she instilled in us a very strong sense of what was right and wrong, a very strong sense of morality. In fact, I remember very strongly growing up, a little different than maybe some of my friends, that I knew it was wrong to pick on someone just because they were different. In fact, I remember it being in the sixth grade, and they passed around a note in class talking about how at recess that day they were going to kind of tease some girl because her nose looked funny, and she'd had some kind of accident or something, and her nose was a little twisted. And I remember thinking, I can't be part of that. I mean, it was this very strong sense that my mother would never allow us to be like that. It may have been in high school, though, before I realized that my mom had gone through something really big, different than to my friends. I'd heard pieces of her story. It's hard for her to share. I want you to know when she comes today, she doesn't do this often, and it takes a lot out of her. But she would share about it occasionally. But most of the things that she would talk about is how when I got married, I was the only daughter, that she wanted to have roses at my wedding. And she would talk about that quite a bit because her dad had always promised that he would have roses at her wedding. And she never had her dad there at her wedding. And so she talked quite a bit about how that was something she really wanted for me. But it wasn't until I was married and my husband and I, Richard, Dan's brother, and I were in visiting at Washington, D.C. at the Holocaust Museum. I had some children by then. That I finally, like the penny dropped, I finally began to understand what my mom had been through. What I remember the most about that particular visit is, if any of y'all have been to the Holocaust Museum, you walk through a room where they have actually some taped testimonies of people that have gone through the Holocaust. And I was stunned at how similar those stories were to the little bits and pieces I'd heard my mom talk about how she was stripped of all her clothes in front of the German guards and how they sprayed her with DDT. I remember feeling sick to my stomach and having a real hard time holding back the tears. But this is what I want to tell you, is that the suffering that my mother has endured has borne tremendous fruit in my life and in the life of my children and my brother's children. Her moral convictions, her faith in God, her love for people, particularly children, have been huge in my life. She's often told me as I was growing up that I needed to count my blessings. And when I would complain, She would regularly talk about how fortunate we are to live in a free country. Just to put it in context, my mother was born the same year as Anne Frank, so that'll help you understand how old she was when she went through this particular time in her life. She was born in 1929. She was a teenager. She was not Jewish, so that made her situation a little bit different. But what you're about to hear is the story of the grace of God, that His grace is sufficient for every situation, and that He uses these times in our lives to bear fruit. So at this time, it's my privilege to introduce you to my mom, Alexandra.
George, where are you? My husband is just walking away. I want y'all to meet him.
George, you need to come back up. Not me. Alexander's giving the orders.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord for this opportunity to witness and tell a little bit about how my wife, how God affected her throughout her life.
This is the love of my life. We've been married 63 years, going on 64. So,
are you sure?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I appreciate so much opportunity to share with you. But you know what? Really, I want to talk about how God is real. God is alive. God is with us. He's always with us. And we don't have to go through a difficult time to find out how real He is and how loving God is. Although sometimes we do have to go through difficult times to find out. Sometimes we find ourselves in a situation that we wish we wouldn't be. But you know, He reveals Himself. He is here, and He's alive, and He's gracious, and He's loving God. In my situation, as Vicky pointed out, I was born in Yugoslavia, and my parents originally came from Russia. They grew up in Russia, and Dad was pretty much involved there in the work at that time of the government involved with work. So when the revolution came, most of the men were sent away to another country in hopes that they would come back. They never dreamed that the Bolshevism would take hold and would be there for so many years. So Mom and Dad were sent to Yugoslavia, and King Alexander was at that time in power, and I remember Dad working there as a child. I remember Dad getting up and going to work and talking about the fact that someday he's going to go back to Russia. Well, I was very fortunate to be born into the family that really loved the country that they came from. They were very much involved in it, and which is good. I think we all should feel that way about the country we're living in and where we're born. I had an older brother, and then I had a twin brother. My twin brother was just a typical little boy that gets in a lot of trouble. And we had some interesting things that happened when we were growing up. We lived in a lovely home. As I pointed out to Vicky, we were fortunate. We lived in but that's not what makes life best, just because you lived in a big home. But we were in a position that they did a lot of entertainment, and so a lot of people came to our home on a special occasion. and they had a concert, and my dad was very much a lover of music, and he played piano very well, and the violin was his very favorite instrument. Unfortunately, my mom died when I was 3 years old, so I really didn't know my mom except through what Dad told me about Mom. And in fact, Dad used to sit in front of the piano and had a big portrait of my mom, and he would say he's playing it to Mom. Because Mom was not there, we had servants and we had a governess that took care of the things that we needed. And we had beautiful gardens. My dad loved the roses, as Vicky pointed out. It was something that I remember my dad walking through the garden. And lots of good fruit in that garden. But Dad would say, someday when you grow up and you get married, I'm going to fill the church with all these roses. So I had such a wonderful memories of my father. He was a very loving father. But, you know, children hear things, and you have to be careful what you say because they will repeat it. One of the expressions that I want to share with you, because I think it's kind of funny in a way, when someone gossips, they say they have a long tongue. And so we had a big gathering in our home, and my little brother came running to the lady and said, can you open your mouth so I can see? She asked him why. He said, my dad said, you have a long tongue. Of course, you know what happened to Walter. He was escorted very quickly, and we were not allowed anymore to come and observe the festivities that were there. There were lots of interesting... My older brother was about 10 years older, actually. And, of course, we were two little monkeys, very mischievous, but I was a nuisance to him, and he would say, okay, if you don't stop, I'm going to put you outside, and the gypsies will come and get you. Well, you know, that's a real thing. In Yugoslavia, actually, there were gypsies would come around and kidnap the children for the ransom, and I knew it was a real thing, so... One day I was mischievous, and my brother put me outside of the door. And I sat on the steps, and lo and behold, down the road came the gypsies. Well, I was hysterical. But fortunately, we had a large space, and there were gates there, so they really would have had to come through them. But he was in trouble after that. My dad was very upset with him. So life went on, and it was some wonderful things, wonderful memories. I remember Christmas time, you know, at Christmas, we had to wait till the first star would appear in the sky before we were serving the food, because there was a very special time, and I remember sitting by the window with my brother waiting to see when the first star shows up in the sky. Then we would be escorted to the big dining room, in a big room, and there was a Christmas tree, and they didn't have electric lights. There were candles on the tree, and they had to light them and then take them off right away. It was a big, big, big celebration time. So wonderful, wonderful memories. When I was at school age, at that point, we had to be sent to a special school. There was school for the boys and school for the girls. It was a sort of a Russian tradition. It was a military-like school for the boys, and it was a special school for the girls. In that school, you were taught everything and everything, music and everything. You go there for 8 years. You come home summertime, but you go there, and you wear uniform, and you're taught how to be proper and young lady. Actually, you don't learn a lot of things. You come out kind of dumb about it after graduation. But anyway, that was a tradition that was to be held, and so we went to the school. I was sent to school. Dad would send someone to come pick me up after school. The car would come and get me, and it was summertime. We had a home on Dubrovnik, in Dubrovnik on the sea, and we would go there summertime, wintertime, we would go up in the mountains. It was a wonderful, wonderful time. Well, when I was home the last time and it was time to go to school, Dad said, I will come and get you. He took me to school, or they drove us to school, and the war began to rage at that point. The Germans occupied the Yugoslavia, and they liked the facility where the school was, and so they sent all the kids home. And those that did not have a home, like it was my situation, found out the home that we had was bombed. And I think it were American and British planes that did that. It was totally demolished. And then everything and everyone in that home was killed. I was sent to the orphanage, to Belgrade. Of course, there were other girls as well that lost the families just like I did. Of course, we didn't know any of that till later. We had nuns that were taking care of us because the monastery is being closed. Tito Mihailovic was raging in Yugoslavia at that time. Draža Mihailovic and Tito, they were all fighting for the position. My older brother, apparently I found out, was drafted by Tito group into the mountains, and they were killed there. I found out later that my little brother was at home at the time when the home was destroyed. So, but I kept waiting for my dad to come and get me. I just knew he told me he was going to come and get me, so I kept waiting for him. And in fact, when we were in the orphanage, we would play the game. We would sit in the garden, and every time the gate would open, would say, "This is for me. This whisker is for me." And it was a, kind of a heart of the orphan wishing desperately for someone to come and get you and someone that you belong to. And something I never experienced before. And so one day the gate opened and it was my turn. It was my turn to have a visitor. It was a gentleman in a German uniform actually came in, and he went and asked the nun if there was a little girl in the orphanage, and he showed the picture. And she said, "Yes, we have her." He said, "Can I see her?" They called me in, and that's when he told me. That he served under my father, because my father joined the Vlasov's army at that time and went underground to fight the Bolsheviks. And he served under him. And so Dad gave him my picture and said, "You know, you're young, you may survive. When you go back, go to look in the orphanages and see if you can find my daughter." So that was the moment that the thing closed up. I knew Dad wasn't coming back. So I didn't wait for him anymore after that. I knew he wasn't coming. So you just have to pick up the pieces and just move on. One of the blessings is the fact that God gave to the children something that they don't think of things that adults do. You know, we just kind of go day by day and accept and kind of roll along with the things. The war was raging and the bombing was going on in Yugoslavia, and we had to go and help pull so many people trapped in the homes. And you just kind of got into the daily routine. We went to school and just didn't wait anymore for Dad to come. And you just kind of went day to accept the day as it came. We had Germans that were close to our orphanages, and they would actually come and ask us to come and go into the trenches when the bombing was taking place. So we thought they were not bad people until one day, at nighttime, they came to the orphanage, and they told us all to get up and not take anything with us. And just follow them to the truck. They put us in the trucks, and then they took us to the train station. And they separated us from our mom, the one that took care of us, who was a wonderful, wonderful lady. She was an older person, had a beautiful gray hair and a beautiful blue eyes, and very loving heart. She cared for all of us. And she was separated with the younger children from the rest of us. And then when we came to the train station, they opened the big cattle cars, and they were full of people, with children, men, women. Didn't know what was happening, didn't know where we were going or what they were going to do. They jammed us all in there. There was, of course, it was no room to even sit down, standing room. It was crammed. And then the train just moved on and went for a long time. At one point, it stopped and opened the doors, and they threw the rotten potatoes on the ground. And many people that were in that train tried to jump down to get some. And they would yell, "You're just pigs. You're nothing but the pigs. Look at you." And humiliation began very much so. There were soldiers, of course, and we found out later there were SS troops, special ones that were assigned by Hitler to guard all of them. They were different. There were Jewish people. There were Russian people like ourselves. There were Polish people. There were even German people that opposed Hitler's government. It was a mixture. And when the train finally came to a stop, there were fence all around, and there were people everywhere in a striped kind of pajama-like clothes. We didn't know where we were, and found out after we went inside, they shaved our heads. They stripped us completely naked into a big room, which don't understand why, but there were guards, men in the corners, and they turned the cold water on us. There were showers that came from the ceiling, and they were. And then they sprayed us with the DTT powder. They told us to go into the corner and pick up anything that's on the ground that we can put on, those kind of pajamas. We put them on, and then they told us to go into the barracks. We found out later that the camp was at Dachau. How many days? I don't know. Forever, seems like forever. The work that we were assigned were the worst thing. It was the big wooden barrels that were filled with the half-dead children, babies, toddlers. It took several of us to hold on to wheel it to the big trenches. We had to throw them in the trenches. And then they would throw acid over it. Obviously, it was a lot of crying, the bunks were not a bunk beds, they were just shelves, wooden shelves up against the wall that you crawl in and find a spot. Had to clean the latrines with our hands, scoop up all that, people die. I don't remember much about the food at all. I don't remember a whole lot of things. Maybe I just wanted to forget quite a bit. But one day, then they took us out of there, quite a few of us, and they put us on the train again, and then they took us to the island Rügen, which is in the North Baltic, in the labor camp. There was a very heavy labor every day. We had to get up at 5 o'clock when the whistle would blow, we'd have to stand outside, wait to be assigned to very heavy work, work on the railroads, laying railroad tracks, digging trenches, making bricks, building for the homes, whatever, farms, everything. Can you imagine for the, and the food was once a day, the truck would come around with a cup of soup, which would be either pea soup with weevils floating on top or a washed down potato soup. Once in a while, you might see a piece of bread. Day after day, with the guard standing over you, if you stop, you're shot. Many died. But the worst part of it is they did a lot of experiments. They gave us a lot of shots. I don't know what they were, but one of time is that I was covered with boils all over, horrible boils, and they were hurting very bad. There was a woman in the group that stole the onion, and if they caught her, she would have been dead. But she stole it, cut it in half, and we had a little stove in the barracks that had just barely warm. It wouldn't even heat up the place. And she would put it up against it and warm it up and then put it on the boils to make it erupt. But then one day they took several of us to a room and they tied to the chair and they took our tonsils out without any anesthesia or anything. Many, many died from bleeding. I don't know why I survived. I have no idea. I just, the one blessing was the fact that I was very little, very small. And so, therefore, I wasn't catching the eye of the soldiers like so many girls have. They've been terribly, terribly abused. Many would come back to the barracks and they would hang themselves or slide their wrists with a piece of metal. Well, it got to be so bad. I have to tell you, when I was growing up, my dad, one thing, I was raised as a Greek Orthodox, which is not a Bible church, but we went to church every Sunday, or even when I was in a private school, I was an altar girl. I served behind the altar, and I really loved that. I really, one thing I came to just really believe that Jesus is our Lord, and I wanted to serve. I wanted to become a nun. Actually, I even dreamed of being a nun so I can spend my time prayer, time with him. But you know what? My dad told me this. Alexandra, I want you to remember one thing. I will not always be around you, but someone that is always there and always watching you is our God. He knows what you're doing. He knows where you are. So be careful. And that was good because it kept me on a straight path. I didn't want to disappoint God and do something wrong. Well, at that camp, that's labor camp, is when I began to question my dad's teaching. I became so embittered that God would allow this to happen. Why? If he's a loving God, why is this happening? And I began to doubt what my dad told me, which is a terrible situation to get yourself into. And I knew I was beginning to hate everybody and everything around me. And I knew it was wrong. And I really wanted to die. I didn't want to live. I didn't want to live because I knew it was wrong. My heart was turning into a bitter heart. And the worse than anything else is doubting that God exists and that he is a loving God. And so I crawled up on my bunk bed, which was up on the top. I had a straw, had no straw mattress or anything, no blanket. It was terrible, cold, and the big rats, huge rats would come at nighttime and bite ears, nose, fingers. I crawled up and I asked, if you really love me, if you really, really love me and you really exist, you will take my life, you will let me die. Please, I cannot live like this. And I just prayed and I prayed and I prayed. And then, you know what? The whistle blew. I wasn't dead. I actually could not believe. I wanted to jump and run outside. I was so happy. What happened is, miraculously, God said, no, you're not going to die, but I'm going to change your heart. I'm going to give you a new heart, a loving heart, a caring heart, compassionate heart, Christ's heart. It's what we pray for, to be like him, which is very difficult. But God can do miracles. God gave me a desire to live. I jumped off that bed, and I ran outside to stand in line to be assigned for work, and I came running to the girls, and I said, guess what? We're going to be okay. And they thought I had lost my mind. They were convinced that I had gone crazy because I was so changed from what I was. They could not believe it. They just knew that I had flipped. But you know what? The change came so drastic. And the change, as far as the work is concerned, never changed. It was just like it was before. But the attitude in my heart was different. I knew God was there with me. I knew that Jesus was there, that he was watching and he will protect us. I knew that. There was no question. So even the work was not as difficult, or you didn't begrudge it because you knew it's going to come to an end. And you know what? I don't know how much time went by. I don't remember now the days, but I do know remember that the guards began to thin out. There weren't so many soldiers around as there were before. And so one night, I said to the girls, you know what? We know our way to the train station, so let's try to get out. They thought, no, you're crazy. I said, no, you know what? God is going to protect us. Jesus is with us. Oh, no, you're crazy. Well, there were 10 of us that got together, and it was evening, and we walked to the gate. We actually crawled to the gate. And guess what? The gate was open, and there was a soldier there with a dog. You would never, ever approach the German Shepherd. But you know what? He didn't move, nobody. Neither dog, neither soldier. They were still. We walked out of that camp and ran to the train station and got into the cattle car just like the one that we came in. And it was empty, and we crawled inside, and we stayed inside. And we just waited to see what happens to the train. We knew the only way off the island is either by train, by car, or boat. And we just sat there. And in the morning, the train began to move and went on and on and on and on. At one point, it stopped. After 2-3 days, and it stopped, and it looked like a forest in front of us. And one of the girls said, I will see how long the train is. And when she stuck her head out, she pulled back and she said, you won't believe it, but the train is big, long, and it was full of German soldiers, and they were all coming out of the train and running into the forest. There was a young soldier that saw her, and he thought she was the only one there. He couldn't see us. He waved frantically to her to jump, jump, run, run fast. He was so convincing that we decided to jump and run into the forest behind all of those running soldiers into the forest. And not very long after we were in the forest, the whole train exploded. Those were the Germans that were evacuating, leaving the island, because we found out later that the Russians were advancing and taking over. Now we understood while the camp was being thinned out, they were leaving. And we found out we were in Lübeck, which is north, and it was occupied by the British occupation forces. And so the planes were flying over the forest, British planes, they were trying to round up the Germans. But Germans, there was a huge, huge, huge number of Germans. They were trying to hide in some homes, but of course there were too many of them. And so in the morning they flushed out the area, and we went out with them, and we were flushed out together with the soldiers. But then they knew we were prisoners, so they separated us and assigned one man, British guy, to take us. And he took us to the apartment building. Came to an apartment, and he knocked on the door. And there was an elderly lady, probably my age at that point, grabbed the tablecloth off of her dining room table and wrapped around her shoulder. She was shaking, because the British soldier was basically telling her to leave her apartment and for us to move into it. And we couldn't do it. We said no. So he put us out on the street. And so when we were on the street, it was not safe. Of course, we were looking for something to eat. Anything, anything, any piece of something we can put in our mouth. Ended up going into the basement, what they call bunkers, which is the German basements where they would go doing the bombing raids. And I guess the Red Cross, they would come to feed the people that were there, sleeping on the floor, concrete floor. At one point, I saw the, up above the street level window, I saw the soldier passing by, and I recognized the uniform, the Yugoslavian uniform. So I ran upstairs to tell them that we were down in the basement, and they took us to their prison camp, which was liberated. And we were given some food, first food. It's so dangerous, because if you eat anything on an empty stomach, it's just excruciating pain. But we were given a Red Cross American packages. It's the first time I heard about the United States. And in that package was the Spam. And of all things, of course, it was a candy, chocolate. But one of the things was also peanut butter. And I've never had peanut butter. Oh, I was so hungry, I took a big wad of peanut butter and I couldn't swallow it. It kind of got caught in my throat. But it was wonderful. We were beginning to feel like we are going to live. Of course, after that, you know what happened? The Germany was divided in the British, American, and Russian zone. And we were in the British zone. So they established the camps. They called displaced person camps. This is for the families that had no country to go to. I had no one in Yugoslavia, so therefore I gave up my citizenship and became stateless. But many Russians that were there were being sent back to Russia, but they didn't want to go back because the Russian government did not believe in that you should be ever caught, so they actually would end up in Siberia. So many of them chose not to go back, and they would literally jump out of windows and trucks and rather than to go back. It's a long story, and I know it took me forever to tell you, but in just basically, you know, things began to settle in those displaced person camps. It was not the home. It was very difficult, but it was a shelter, and they gave you food, a ration for 1 week, and you have to be very careful not to eat it all at one time. But the God is gracious. There's always one of the things that I know for a fact, that you can see Christ in a real sense. And how you see him in people. So when we ask the Lord to come into our heart, we need to be able to live the life that that exemplifies his love through us. And this is how he reveals himself in people. And so God sent these different people in my life that I felt his presence and his love and care, because they were willing to reach out to the girl that had no one. In this dispersion camp one day, a young man, well, in his early 30s, came to the camp organizing Girl Scouts. Girl Scouting was a working organization in Europe. It was not just a recreation. It was really you were a working group of kids. And I found out that he happened to be my godbrother, which is not a blood kin. But you know, when mom died, I had a godmother. And godmother was very important in my life. And he was her son, same age as my older brother. And so he had a picture of me also. And this is why in that little booklet that we have, the pictures that are in there are really pictures that I didn't have. They were the ones that were brought in on those occasions. And he wanted to take me back to American Zone where he lived in this dispersion camp. He was married to a lovely young lady from Russia. But the organization would not allow me to leave the camp. So he had to leave. So a month later, some sweet people that cared enough about me put me in a mail bag and put me on a train in a mail bag. And that's how I went to American Zone from British Zone. And so there are always a ways God works it out for you. At one point, I was, you know, they had to send people somewhere. They couldn't stay in Germany all the time. So many people went to England, some New Zealand, some Australia. They would assign them, and they assigned me to go to Casablanca, Morocco. Can you imagine? But, you know, God intervened in that as well. God intervened. He found a family that came to the United States. And they asked for someone to sponsor me to come to the United States. So in 1948, at age 19, I received my passport. And that's a long story, interesting story, because when I went to Frankfurt to get my passport and stood in line forever, all night long. It was on a train, and then when you get there, you stand in line and you wait, and I came to the window, which was my turn to get the passport, and all of a sudden there was a sign put on the window, coffee break. So that was the introduction to the American way of living, you know. So I came to United States, and I remember getting into Bremerhaven, where the ship was, with a little cardboard suitcase full of books, no clothes. That's another thing. You know, you didn't have anything. And my teaching of what my Lord, my dad told me, that be careful, Alexandra, don't do anything that would disappoint God. There were many times in a displaced person camp that the girls were introduced to wrong things for the sake of getting some clothes. And I was so fortunate among some others that were strong enough to say no. And this is why I tell young girls, be careful. God is there, he sees you. And he is crushed, because our God wants us to live the life that would be honoring him and be lived a pure life. So I was in Bremerhaven on a ship, Marina Swallow, and I remember standing on the deck waiting for that rope to be untied. I was so afraid that it's not going to untie and it's not going to go. And on the ship coming to the United States, it's something of the very memorable moment, is seeing a Statue of Liberty. I want to tell you, we should never take for granted being Americans. Never. never take for granted being able to live in a country where we can worship like today. Never. And I pray that today, especially today, for us to not to be indifferent to what's happening in the world today. We should be very aware of our Christian brothers and sisters are being slaughtered in the countries they're not next door, but it can happen here. Just like during the Nazi time, people did not even care because they're pretending that they didn't know. Many of them knew. But too busy with our lives to pay attention to what's happening. And we're too busy today and indifferent. This is what's happening outside of our perimeter of our country. We say, oh, we're so far away from that place, from those areas. They're not going to be here. Well, let me tell you, we're fooling ourselves. We are really fooling ourselves. We need to be praying very hard as believers for our brothers and sisters, and we need to be praying that our government would get to the point that we can do what needs to be done to protect those that are being slaughtered over there, the children that are being buried alive, the children that are being cut to pieces and mothers are eating them as a food because it's given to them and they don't know that's what their child is. How can we be so indifferent? How can we be so busy not to see this? And I pray for God's sake that we would not be closing our eyes. Think of our children, our grandchildren that are living here. What are we leaving them for them? And we as Christians, we need to be strong enough and brave enough to stand up and speak, open our voices and question what is happening. And I appreciate the opportunity that you all have come to hear a person that is getting older. I'm getting older. I'm 85. But God has given me extra years for some reason. Maybe it is to speak out. But be also thankful for the eyes that you have, because I've lost my peripheral vision, so I'm having a difficult time walking because I cannot have a good judgment in my walk. It's affecting my walking too. But you know what? I praise God every day that I open my eyes and remember Him, that He saved me for some reason from the horror that could have so many are faced. And I'm thankful also that we can be strong enough to stand behind Israel. Oh, let me tell you, those people are God's chosen people. Israel is the land where our Jesus came from. And those people need us. They need us to lead them to the Messiah. Their Messiah, our Messiah. We need to speak up very strongly to stand behind Israel and defend that country that has been our support for so many years. So I thank you so much for being patient to listen to my rattling and talking. And I hope that you will remember one thing is never, never forget what has happened and never, never allow to happen here. And by God's grace, lean on our Savior who is forever here, and we are to follow Him and follow in His footsteps. Thank you so much.
Just a couple things, and then we'll be dismissed. I've been told by our people who watch the parking lot, we tried to have space available. People didn't know there was parking down the hill at the school. The parking lot, a lot of congestion. We will have people out there to assist people getting out. No road rage, parking lot rage out there. It will work out. Feel free to stay around. But just a couple thoughts. If you've ever gone to a Nazi concentration camp, at least in Dachau, behind the glass, there are symbols of hope. And the thing I've never forgotten is behind that glass, there were little images of crosses that people had made, some out of string, some out of straw, some out of human hair. But they hid those things because what gave them hope was the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm grateful that I, and I'd like to think every one of us here, do not have a story like Alexandra's. But we all have a story. There's a lot of heartache there. There's a lot of disappointment. But at the end of the heartache, at the end of the disappointment, there's hope. But that hope is found in the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for our sins and offers forgiveness and a personal, eternal relationship with Him, to any who will trust in His death. And if you've never done that, I hope that you will. On the platform to my right are two of Alexandra's grandchildren. They're going to sing Alexandra's favorite song. It's a hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." After they sing, we'll be dismissed in prayer. And thank you for coming.
It is well with His glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear.
Let's pray together. We thank you for the opportunity, Father, to gather in the name of Jesus and give you worship. We thank you that the story we've heard is all about your grace, all about your goodness. Ultimately, it's all about Jesus who died for us and takes care of us. We pray, Father, that we would leave here in his name with the encouragement that you provide, you guide, and you protect. And for that, it's just another reason for which we give you worship in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming. Depart with the hope of Jesus Christ.